Are you sick and tired of seeing your plants die because of dark, gloomy winters? Does your plant put out small leaves or long, unsightly stems? Are your plants not blooming despite all of your efforts? Do you spend endless hours reorganizing your plants so that one plant would receive more light? Do you go over endless pages on the internet searching for the best light solution for your plants, but you keep ending up on marijuana forums? Are you constantly shocked by the prices of grow lights, thinking how you will never be able to afford them? Well, no worries. I'm here to tell you that it doesn't have to be so hard, and you can actually provide your plants with adequate light and save some money for your other addictions. Well, that one was a joke. We all know you're saving money to buy new plants. Hello, friends. If you're new to my channel, my name is Miro, and welcome. This hand, I don't know what to do with this hand, doesn't fit on the desk because of the plants. Also, coffee and a white sweatshirt. That looks like a good choice, doesn't it? Today we will talk about lights, artificial lights that you can use for your plants, and how to get a decent result when you're growing them. The winter is slowly approaching in the northern hemisphere, and you may have noticed that you don't have as much light as you used to. Several months ago, I would still get light coming through my window after 8 p.m., and now I barely get any light after 3:30 p.m., and usually after 4 p.m. it is complete darkness outside. Even if you have many windows, and if you have southern windows, you still may not be getting enough light for your plants. Or you can be like me, working only with a couple of windows and a burning desire to have more plants, and maybe with some space where you could put plants, but there is not enough light there and nothing can survive except spiders. Well, today I wanted to talk about how I overcome this issue and how I grow so many plants working only with two northwest facing windows. When I restarted my plant collection about 4 years ago, I didn't have so many plants like I do today, and most of them were actually very close to my window or living in the windowsill. And sure, it was a bit difficult to water them without not knocking one of them over, but they were still growing very nicely. Unfortunately, slowly my Hoya obsession started to kick in, and then orchids joined them, and I no longer had enough natural light to grow all of these plants. Just kidding, it wasn't that slow at all. So, what to do? Well, obviously, use some artificial light. Now, this is much easier to say than to do. Very quickly, you will end up on the internet and you will be overwhelmed by the choice that you have of these grow lights at the different prices. And also, you will be faced with some words that you may not be sure what they mean, like kelvins and watts and foot candles and wavelengths and lumens and lux and pars and blah, blah. So many words. Oh, and yeah, you will most likely end up on some possibly shady and illegal forums, depending where you live. I was in the same situation about 15 months ago, and I was swimming in all this information, and I didn't quite know what to do with that. Do I reduce the number of plants that I have? Do I invest all my money in one good grow light? Do I go on AliExpress and buy some of those cheap lights that they market as grow lights and, you know, get possibly subpar performance? Do I become a witch and go to a forest and dance during the fall equinox, praying for more sun this winter? Instead of doing any of those things, I actually contacted a Hoya grower from whom I previously bought some cuttings to ask what light they are using, because it really seemed impossible to me for someone to have so many plants and to rely simply on natural light. After all, not many of us live in Versailles with the abundance of windows. What I found out from this grower is that you can basically use any LED light that is high enough in wattage and that has appropriate color temperature, and you can find these lights in hardware stores, electrical supply stores, or even in some larger supermarkets. I was told I could simply use a cool white LED light, which would be around 6500 kelvins, with a wattage of around 30 watts, and that light would be sufficient for Hoyas. Of course, you can go lower, but I was told I shouldn't really go below 18 watts because that wouldn't be strong enough for Hoyas. Now, I do want to get a bit more into this because it does get slightly more complicated than that. And just a fair warning, what I will share with you is just some of my experience. You may have a different experience, but I'm pretty sure you can get pretty much the same results and you can grow your plants really nicely in the same lights that I am using. First of all, I would like to say that I do not use any lights that are marketed as grow lights. And there are several reasons for this. First, and the most important reason for me is the cost. If you're looking to buy a light that is marketed as grow light and that comes from a reputable manufacturer with good reviews, you are looking at around $200 per one LED tube. Some can cost less, some can cost more, depending what light you are looking into. None of these lights are available in my country, so to that price I would have to add the shipping costs, the import costs, and I would risk them being damaged in transport. And that is just one light, and I need much more than just one light, unfortunately. Because of this, I decided I will not go with the grow light, with one grow light, and after I reached out to that Hoya grower, I decided to try with just one LED tube from the local hardware store. After a couple of weeks, I could see that my plants were doing really nicely under that one LED tube, so I went out and I bought four more. And then I added six more, and then five more, and then two more light bulbs. I'm actually using now one to record the video. And two spotlights. Now I live in Las Vegas and my house is like a casino, but instead of slot machines, I have plant shelves with plenty of plants and a light that can decently light up the sidewalk at night. So, you know, if you ever get lost in the darkness, just follow the light and you will come to my window, look inside and wonder, why the heck does this guy have so many plants? It took me about 15 months and still now I'm learning about the appropriate distance of the light from the plant, and you know, here and there you will get a sunburn or light burn, or you will see that maybe you're not giving the plant enough light. So it is a learning process and there is no really a quick way to figure it out. It's a really trial and error, but I will share with you what I learned so far. Before you ask, the electrical bill didn't increase for me all that much. It really costs less than running an electrical heater or a washing machine. At least for me that is the case. What I learned over these 15 months is that while wattage is very important, you can get away with using lesser wattage if you position your plant close enough to the light. I do this with some of my Phalaenopsis, Paphiopedilums, even these Dendrobiums, violets, and even some smaller plants or cuttings. They all grow under a 10 watt LED light, and this does help to reduce the cost of the electrical bill. Of course, there is an issue with this. When they start to spike, they have to be moved somewhere else. But for the majority of time, they can grow happily under this 10 watt LED light as well. Some higher light orchids such as Vendaceous types or Cattleyas cannot really grow well under such light, it is just too weak for them. So for those I use a 36 watt LED tube with a color temperature of 6500 Kelvin and around 2900 lumens. I did have Cattleya bloom under this light. For my Vendaceous types, we still have to wait and see. My Hoyas also grow under the same 36 watt LED tube, and I can say that for some of them it is a bit too much. If you have seen my 30 days of Hoya, you probably have seen that some of them will start to get smaller leaves and the leaves will become very red. Now, I do know that some people find this look quite attractive. For me, it's really not what I find to be attractive, so I did make several adjustments. Another thing that I need to mention is that I use only one LED tube per one level of my plant shelf, so not entire level of the shelf will get the same amount of light. The LED tube has a certain width. The strongest light will be when you place a plant directly under the central axis of that tube. That means if you move it a bit off to one side of that axis, the plant will start to receive less light. I do use this to my advantage. I will put light-loving plants directly under the central axis of the LED light, or you can put some smaller cuttings that are very far away from the light, you can put under there and they will receive enough light. If there is a plant that requires less light, I will move it a bit off to the side from that central axis, and that way it will not get burned. I actually noticed that I can get away with hanging plants on the side of my plant shelf, such as Hoya lacunosa or Hoya bella, that don't require so much light, and they will do actually very fine there and even bloom there. I do this with my Hoyas, but the same rule really applies to any other plant. Another important factor is the distance from the LED light. Now, the LED lights are usually very cool to the touch. Not cold, but if you touch them, you can leave your hand there and you're not going to get burned. Most likely, there are some LED lights that do heat up, but most of mine don't really heat up. Distance from the light is very important because plants do tend to grow towards the light. I had some of my Hoyas pushing out new vines and they would go straight for the LED light against their better judgment, and they would end up directly into LED light and they would get burned and die back. They would get burned because they received just way too much light. For Hoyas, it is really easy to fix this. You can just simply put a trellis right away, and as the vine starts to grow, you just train it to grow around that trellis and, you know, make sure that it doesn't go into the light. But I strongly suggest that you get plant shelves with the adjustable height of the level. Trust me, you will thank me for this. And also, the easier it is to adjust, the better the plant shelf. Another thing that is also important to consider is the distance from the top of the plant to the light and from the bottom of the plant to the light. As you know, all plants have a certain height, unless they are herbaceous, then they're kind of flat-ish. But if you're growing Hoyas or if you're growing orchids, it's very important that the bottom leaves also receive enough light, not just the top leaves. This means that maybe the top of your plant will receive a bit too much light and you will have sun-stressed leaves, but I think that could be acceptable within limits. Of course, you need to kind of figure this out for your plants as well. I find that for my Hoyas, 45 to 50 centimeters from the bottom leaves works really well. That way there is enough space for them to grow, and you know, I can also adjust the distance as they become larger. Another possible fix for this is that you will use a side light as well. So maybe if you don't want to burn the top of your foliage and you want to move the level a bit down so you have distance from the light, you can include a side light, and that way, you know, the entire plant will get enough light. A good indicator if your plant is receiving enough light can be to look at the foliage. For example, for some Hoyas, the leaves will start to get smaller and they will start to get a bit red if it's receiving too much light. On Hoya australis, they can also become a bit chlorotic. For orchids, it is the same thing. If it's receiving too much light, the leaves can start to look a bit yellowish. They're supposed to be kind of light green, but you will notice, trust me, when the plant looks unhealthy, when it looks as if it's receiving too much light. The same goes if it's not receiving enough light. You will see that it's kind of slow to grow, or maybe the internodes are getting too long, too large. Really, the best thing is to look at your plant, you know, take your time, try to figure it out. One thing that I learned in these 15 months is that really there are no shortcuts, and this is something that you have to figure out for yourself. What do you need to look for when you buy LED lights? Well, I can tell you the things that I look at when I buy my LED lights. The first thing to look for are the watts. Usually, more watts the light has, the brighter it will end up being. Now, this doesn't always have to be true. You kind of have to look at watts in relation to lumens. Now, this is where it becomes interesting. The LED lights that we use for our home measure the brightness in lumens. But these LED lights have a bit more green color to them because that is the most pleasant to our eyes. To talk more about the lights, I did contact my friend Annabel, and she has a YouTube channel, The Orchid Room. If you are interested in growing orchids, she has plenty of them. Most of them are growing in semi-hydro, so her channel is also very useful for you if you're growing plants in semi-hydro, because you will get a more scientific point of view and you will find out what works and what doesn't, and you will be very knowledgeable. At least I feel like I always become much smarter after I watch one of her semi-hydro videos. She has been growing her plants under LED lights much longer than I have, and she has used both grow lights and the regular LED lights. The typical grow light will usually be a balance between color temperatures of 3000 kelvins and 5000 kelvins. This is why sometimes you will see on LED grow lights that you have differently colored LEDs. You know, they mix together and they create a perfect light for your plant. It has been said that plants benefit the most from red and blue wavelengths. This is the most basic explanation. People usually say that color red in the light is good for flowering, and the blue color is good for foliage growth. If you use an LED light for your plant, like common household LED light, and if you pick a color temperature of around 6500 kelvins, it will have more blue in it than red. This doesn't mean that it will not have red at all, it will have some red, but it will be more to the blue side. Now, depending on the light that you pick, depending on the watts and the lumens, you can get a light that is powerful enough and that will have enough red color in it. This is what happened with my Cattleya too. I grow it under the 36 watt, 2900 lumens and 6500 kelvins LED light, and I was able to bloom it under that light. There was enough red in it. In fact, I think it will bloom again, but shh, let's not put any pressure on her. I was also able to bloom several Hoyas under this light, and also these two orchids that you can see here, they also bloomed under the same light. Now, I did see that some people use a combination of colors, so they will put one LED that is around 3000 kelvins and one that is cooler light, maybe around 6500 kelvins. The colors will mix and that will be ideal light for your plant, in theory. Additionally, what you can do is you can pick a light that is slightly warmer. For example, somewhere around 4000 kelvins to 5000 kelvins. I cannot give you my experience on using this light. I haven't tried it. As I said, most of my lights, or all of my lights, are actually cool white LEDs. But when I try it, and I hope I do, I will let you know how it works out for me. Of course, there is a benefit to using actual grow lights if you can afford them. As you probably noticed, these lights are not fine-tuned to work for plants, the common household LED lights. So that means that there is a lot of waste in terms of light. The actual grow lights, the good grow lights, are tuned, the wavelength is tuned, so that they are much more efficient for your plants. And another thing that I need to mention, and I'm sorry if this offends anyone, but I'm not a believer in cheap LED grow lights like the light that sell on AliExpress that is actually purple. I just don't believe in those. I have never seen that they have any specific rating on them, like power rating, so I'm not a believer in those. I would much rather spend my money on typical household LED lights because I know that those work. But if you have purchased one of those cheap $20 or $10 AliExpress LED lights that are grow lights, let me know in the comments below how they work out for you. Hopefully this video was useful for you and you got a better idea of what light you can use for your plant. To just recap it, I use lights that are anywhere from 10 watts to 36 watts. Mostly there are 36 watts, but I do have about 4 or 5 that are 10 watts that I use for violets, for smaller plants, and some lower light orchids. Also, when it comes to lumens, they go from 900 lumens for those 10 watt lights and up to 2900 lumens for those 36 watt LED lights. They are all, I believe, from 6000 to 6500 Kelvin in terms of color temperature, and I can say that they really work well for my plants. That's it. That's the whole LED light science. At least the cheap LED light science. I hope that you enjoyed the video. If something is left unclear, make sure to leave a comment below, and if I know the answer, I will try to reply. And if I don't know the answer, I'll just simply say, I don't know. I would also like to know what type of LED light you are using for your plant, or if you're using any LED lights at all. If you like the video, make sure to give it a thumbs up, and if you're not a subscriber, I mean, the subscribe button doesn't bite, neither does the bell notification button. I also now have a Patreon account, and the link to that will be in the description below. I hope you're all having a wonderful day, and thank you so much for watching. I hope that the video was enjoyable and informative. No craziness this time. See you in another video. Bye! I would like to take a moment to thank my patrons. A majestical shout out to my $5 patrons, Betsy Begonia, Kathy L, Melissa Walker, Nicole Ferranti, Vicky Dingler, and my one anonymous patron, and a big shout out to my $3 patrons, Becca Penyard and Nikki. Once again, thank you so much for your support. You're truly wonderful, and I hope that you're having a great time watching these videos.